Kim, did you do one where you burnt the marshmallow completely in the fire yet?
Julie, you're charred. You're very charred.
In this episode of Chemists in the Kitchen, we're going to be talking about s'mores. And most specifically, we're going to be talking about the single ingredient of marshmallows, and in particular about how those marshmallows can change by the different methods that we can heat them in order to give you the delicious flavors that you associate with a s'more. I am Julie Pollack, and I am an associate professor of chemistry at the University of Richmond.
Hi everyone, I'm Kim Jacoby Morris. I'm the STEM program coordinator for the Air Force Office of Scientific Research.
Hey, I'm Matt Hardings. I'm an associate professor of chemistry at American University.
So I went to the grocery store and bought marshmallows, but to learn a little more about what goes into a marshmallow, Matt's gonna walk us through how he actually made homemade marshmallows.
So my daughter Claire and I made marshmallows over the weekend. We used gelatin and sugar. The first thing you have to do is heat some water and some sugar. Being the chemists that we are very well versed in the fact that water has a boiling point of 100 degrees Celsius, or around 212 degrees Fahrenheit. And that doesn't change. One of the things that we learn in chemistry is that you add more stuff to the water that you're trying to boil, the boiling point changes. And so when we're making marshmallows, the first step in getting them right is getting just the right amount of water left in our sear. So the next thing you have to do is you need to mix in something that is going to help your sugar, your syrup, set into the texture that you want. And so for this case, we're using gelatin, same stuff that's in Jell-O. So we add our sugar mixture, our syrup, and we wait till it gets to the right temperature, right? Added the gelatin, let the gelatin get all melty, right? You have to get your gelatin to dissolve in your syrup. And then we turn our mixer on high and let it spin round and round like crazy. And what that's doing is it's whipping air into your gelatin. And your gelatin is, as it's mixing and dissolving, it's grabbing hold onto other gelatin pieces. And you're making this network, but you're pumping air into it as well. And you keep doing that mixing until you pump enough air in, until the gelatin cools down enough.
So I'm excited to see. Can we see what the squishiness of your marshmallows look like?
Here's how squishy they are. I'm gonna try not to get this all over my computer. But they're good and squishy, and now my hands are all messy. Yeah. But you know, you let them cool, and then you coat them in powdered sugar so they don't stick to one another.
So I have regular marshmallows, and I was looking at the ingredients this morning, and so obviously the regular marshmallows, right, we start out with corn syrup and sugar, of course. It also has some whipping aid, so it has tetrasodium pyrophosphate as a whipping aid. So that's interesting that they're helping it to like bring in. I'm interested, do you have the same kind, Kim?
I think I have the same kind, but the tetrasodium pyrophosphate, isn't that also in instant pudding?
Probably, yeah. So maybe that's to like help with incorporating the air. I'm assuming it's a phosphate, so I'm assuming it would interact with the air in some sort of capacity to maybe hold it in as you're whipping it in. I don't know. Vegan marshmallows. Not that there's anything wrong with vegan marshmallows, but these are
tiny little ones.
I'll open them up in a minute. Like Matt was talking about, has, instead of in it gelatin, it has carrageenan, which is basically from seaweed, and so that's what's going to act as the gelatin to be able to mix into it, but because it doesn't come from animals, then these are actually vegan marshmallows. Well, obviously the size is very different. Because I bought the s'more size, because these fit perfectly on the square. But I would say, so actually, the vegan marshmallow is a little squishier than the regular marshmallow. So, should we get to cooking them, making s'mores?
We're gonna have some fun. Let's just play around and see what we get.
So I will be using my fireplace in my kitchen, and also comparing that to my microwave. And then I believe Julie's going to use a broiler, and Matt's going to use a propane tank.
I've got a propane torch, Home Depot special, and a can of Sterno.
So we should see a really neat comparison between all our different marshmallows and how they roast up.
I'm gonna turn on my broiler.
All right, I'm gonna crack open my Sterno first.
All right, in order to do my broiler, I'm actually gonna put them on top of the graham cracker first.
Because
otherwise I'm not gonna be able to scoop I don't think I'm gonna be able to scoop my marshmallow off of the pan if I don't have that.
Nope.
So I have two marshmallows on my skewer ready to go. I'm going to try to just focus on just using the convection, so the hot air, toasting the marshmallows so they're not totally charred like Julie was mentioning before. But maybe we can do that as well, since it should be relatively quick.
So I'm gonna do the same thing over my Sterno. I've got one of my store-bought marshmallow here. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna try to not get any toasting at all. I just want to warm my marshmallow up and see what happens just as I warm it up without doing any toasting.
All right, I've started. I have my vegan two marshmallows on top of this, and then my one non-vegan marshmallow on top of that. And so I'm going to put it in. I have my broiler on high, and I have the rack as close to the top of my oven as I can.
I'm trying to be really patient here with not overheating mine, because I just, a little browning there, I just want to warm it up.
All right, I'm starting to get some browning on the top of both of my marshmallows.
Okay, so here's my just warmed up marshmallow with an uncooked marshmallow. PV equals NRT, so as we increase the temperature, we increase the volume of space that our gas inside of this takes up.
So my marshmallows are also finished. I have a light brown color around the edge.
Does get super gooey. All right, I'm gonna try one of mine. Right, it's always that battle between how quick you cook it and how much you brown it, right? Because if you cook it too slow, it gets too goopy on the inside and then they fall off your skewer.
Which is the beauty of cooking it on top of the graham cracker in this, so you
right?
still have the gooiness and it has like a crunch on the top of it, which actually this is way less messy, and it would be less messy if I wasn't. The vegan marshmallow, not as gooey. It's not as gooey. I'm gonna.
Hmm.
This one, way gooier.
Is everyone using like Hershey's chocolate or a different type of chocolate for their s'mores? I recently learned that there are 6 different crystal forms of chocolate.
Oh.
And number 5 is what's commercially available.
Well, it should be.
Interesting.
Melt in your mouth, not in your hand kind of thing. So for my organic chemists.
There's so much cool chemistry about chocolate forming and getting the right, tempering your chocolate to get to the right crystal form so that the chocolate crystals melt in your mouth and not in your hand.
Oh, are you going with a torch now?
Yeah, once I get it lit.
Oh, you're a Sterno. I think this particular s'more is a good illustration of the fact that marshmallows are just mostly air, mm-hmm. right? We talked about that a little bit in the beginning, and air is such a good thermal insulator.
I'm doing the low on my broil now as opposed to the high.
Yeah.
To see how we do here. So, and I also put the chocolate on before.
Okay. All right. So here's that's nice and brown. I'm gonna use my torch to melt my chocolate.
Tim, did you do one where you burnt the marshmallow completely in the fire yet?
Julie, you're charred. You're very charred.
Did it expand as much, or is it still cold in the center now?
It didn't expand as much, but once it actually was aflame, you sort of hear the sizzling.
Our good friend, the Maillard reaction.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, so you went past caramelization to caramelization of just the sugars to straight up reaction of the proteins and the sugars together.
When we get browning in marshmallows, it's really the Maillard reaction. You're the proteins in the marshmallow from the gelatin or other things that you might add are gonna react with the sugars that are also in your marshmallow.
Ah.
When we're cooking these, the first thing that happens, that first browning that you get, is the Maillard reaction. You have to get up to higher temperatures before the sugars start reacting with one another.
So I'm gonna pop these into the microwave. So I have them in a unique formation, right? Because the way that microwaves work,
you have molecules that are dielectric, right? So you're taking your water and basically forcing it to rotate really quickly, disrupting hydrogen bonding networks, having it align with an electric field from your magnetron. So we're gonna see if we can try and identify cold spots in my microwave with the marshmallows. So maybe some of them will pop up and hopefully not explode in my microwave. Don't want to clean it later, but we'll see.
All right, I'm gonna enjoy this one that definitely melted the chocolate significantly better. Here, definitely melted the chocolate better when you put it in. And I'm gonna try not to get it all over myself.
All right. So one of the things I've always enjoyed doing is getting some of this getting it toasty on the outside and getting a little skin on it. And then, look at this. Now I'm just making a mess. Actually, this might work, right? So you build up a little skin on the outside of it. And then that, right, you should be able to pull off. It should stick, right? You can pull off, eat this part, delicious. And then you're gonna toast it again. So here you go, you get to come back, get to toast some more, right? So. Mm-hmm.
So luckily, nothing exploded in my microwave, so 10 seconds or less for anyone who was up wondering.
Does it taste different, Kim? Microwave versus in the fire?
So I like the taste in the fire better, right? Because you have that Maillard reaction going on, and you can definitely taste a difference. But I'm not gonna lie, it's kind of nice having like uniform warmth through the marshmallow.
I do like these homemade ones. They're a little bit crunchier on the outside after you brown them than the store-bought.
Do you think it has to do with the fact that the powdered sugar is on it?
The ones you get at the store, the ones that are mass produced, they have really tight controls over how much water is in them. Like, they're so much better controlled than what I can do in my kitchen, right? So they have these really just incredible processes. And so I think probably it has to do with mine having a little bit more water in it. Otherwise, it's mostly the same stuff.
So my question is, Matt, is it worth it to make marshmallows for a s'more, or is it worth just buying the s'mores?
I have a lot of fun making things. I think they taste delicious. My daughter, again, when we were making them, she's like, oh, let's make these again when it's the holidays. We can put peppermint in them, we can do this, we can do that. And so they're ready to make all sorts of crazy marshmallows.
So when I was first toasting, so just that light brown marshmallow, I really took advantage of convection. And so what is this? It's this idea that you have this circular motion of air, right? Where you have warm air rising to the top of your fireplace, right? The heat rises, and then any cold air, which is more dense, is going towards the bottom. So I'm taking advantage of that hot air rising to toast my marshmallow. So that's an example of convection.
So there's also radiation. You can cook through radiation. So think of radiation when you go outside and it's a sunny day. It feels warm because the sun is beating down on your face. That is. You're being cooked by radiation when you go outside. And so we can do the same things here, right? So hot things radiate electromagnetic waves. They radiate radiation. You can cook our marshmallows that way too, right? When you're cooking over a fire, the logs that you're using, or the sterno that I'm using here, or even, right, what Julie was doing in her stove using the broiler, you have a really hot material that is radiating energy away from it. And that energy then is what helps you to cook. So we had a lot of fun today. We ate some marshmallows, we toasted some marshmallows, and most importantly, we played with fire. I know we all grew up toasting marshmallows over fires, but there's lots of different ways you can cook marshmallows. And really, it's about getting whatever you want out of your cooking. And so the different methods will do different things for you. You can cook your marshmallows in a microwave and have them be nice and soft and squishy with none of the browning. You can cook them under a broiler on top of the graham cracker already, and you have your s'mores already made for you, right? It's a haute couture s'mores going on right there. So really, right, just thinking about how you want your marshmallow to melt, how you want it to brown, how you want to eat it, what you want it to taste like, right? You can get at that using any of these different methods. So go home, have fun, play with fire.
You probably want to put a disclaimer in there, Carrie.